Praise God. Come on, let's pray together. Heavenly Father, today we want to say thank you that we're part of that church that you gave birth to, and we're part of that community of men and women who now live victorious because of what Jesus did on Calvary. We're part of that community, Lord, that are forgiven and made whole and healed because of what Jesus did on Calvary. Father, today we want to say thank you. Thank you for such a great salvation. Thank you for dying in our place. Thank you for taking away our sin and washing us clean. Thank you, God, for giving us a brand new life and being born again, Lord. We thank you today, Father, for the life that you've given us to live and the purpose that's ahead of us and the eternity, the everlasting life that we're now enjoying. Father, we give you thanks. We pray today, God, that as we once again want to hear you speak to us, Father, as we want to hear your whisper in our ear, as we today, Lord, want to open ourselves to receive from you once again, Lord, that you would once again, Father, speak to us by your Spirit, that your voice would be clear in our ears today, that your voice would be clear in our hearts today, Lord, as we want to honor you and give you glory, Lord. And we praise you, Lord, for all that you are and all that you've done. And Lord, all that you're going to be for us, we give you thanks. In Jesus' wonderful and mighty name, amen, amen. Amen. Praise God. Great to see you today. And as Olu's already said, we give you an extra special, a great welcome. Thank you for being here with us today. It's going to be a good day today. It's one of those, I guess, preaches that we hope will be kind of one of those that helps us to be picked up and move forward, help us to get up and get going for the next week that is ahead of us, for the next days that are ahead of us. It's one of those times where we think, oh good, that's great, that these are the things that I need to do to help me step forward in the life that God has got planned for me. I trust you lean in again today. We're still in the book of Ezra and Haggai. Today we're in Haggai, and we're going to have a look at some stuff together. Can I remind you that next week is a special weekend? We've got Craig Johnson with us, and it's going to be an amazing time as he comes and shares not only what it means for us to become a church that is autism and kids with difficulties friendly, that we open ourselves up and become better at how we do that, but also the fact that he's going to be with us speaking on Sunday morning. We take a break out of our series, and Craig is going to be here. If you're interested in being part of that meeting, the teaching meeting, I guess, that he's talking and inspiring on Saturday, please go on the website or head to the Next Steps point and sign up for that. That would be great. We've got so many people already coming, and we'd love to fill the room downstairs with people who are interested in either have got some challenges in their own world, but also those that are saying, you know what, I think that God has designed me to give my life away on behalf of others in this arena. So it would be amazing if this opportunity for each of us kind of fires us up and gets us going. I don't know what it takes for you to live different. I don't know what it takes for you to be changed. I don't know what it takes for you to shift the course of your life or to have a course correction in your life. Everybody's different in the room, I'm sure, but I don't know what it takes for us to move and shift and be transformed and changed. And I was thinking this last week just of my daughter, who I was so impressed with, who managed to do that thing from, it's called From Couch to 5K. Anybody heard of Couch to 5K? Those like me who are couch kind of people, and they get to 5K, and it got me all inspired, and I went and downloaded all the stuff from the NHS. Couch to 5K in 9 weeks. It even gives you this is a better one, an 8-week plan for beginners, that's me. And I was all excited and inspired and thinking, I could maybe do this. I could go maybe couch to coach, that would be better. But but I thought I could maybe have a go at couch to 5K. And I got all inspired and I got all excited and I got the stuff, I gathered the information, I read the detail, I got all going to get up and go, and then I just got myself a bit sensible, but not today. But there may be a time. But as I was thinking about all of that stuff, about what does it take for us to shift and change, actually all of us are on the spiritual journey from couch to 5K. All of us are on that kind of journey that takes us from where we are to where God wants us to be. And all of us are being inspired, I hope, and challenged this year to get up and go. You know, we've already started the year looking that there's a harvest ahead of us. There's a harvest that God has got prepared for us. But it takes you and I to be mobilized, as Tom reminded us in the last Sunday of that series, to be the harvesters. And it's going to take us to get up and go. And our foundation text, our foundation statement, is from Haggai 1:7-8. We're going to read it this morning. It says, consider your ways. Give careful thought to your ways. Get up and go. to the mountains and bring down timber and build my house so that I may take pleasure in it and be honored. We're looking back at this story from 2,500 years ago, where this group of Jews currently in captivity were given that invitation to get up and go, to leave captivity and go and build God a house, to go back to Jerusalem and build God a place of residence that his name would be honored and his name would be glorified. And the same challenge comes for us today, that it would be our moment, our time, our opportunity to build God a house in our heart, but also for us collectively to build God's residence, as it were, a house in for him to stay in this city of ours, in this nation of ours. And we saw how the children of Israel, the Israelites, had shifted. They were full of passion. They headed up the road and they began. Momentum was theirs. Passion was high. And they all participated and joined in. But then something happened last week and we saw that things changed and stuff happened and they came crashing. Their couch to 5K journey came crashing to a halt. Just watch this video behind and it'll give you a little picture of a get up and go moment. Was tipped to win that race. He held the British record for the 400 meters. And I'm sure many of you can remember and know that story very well. He was the fastest time in the first round. He won his quarter final, and now here he was expecting in the semi-final to win. And of course, what happened was there, his hamstring pulled and down he went. And we see as he tried his best to get up and go and run that something happened and the hamstring went and he ended up on the deck there. And for these Israelites, as they ran, as they began to get up and go, we saw last week how their passion disappeared, how distraction had tried to replace their passion, how discouragement and had taken away and succeeded in removing their passion, how division and going in different directions, the enemy had come in and tried to take away their passion, how basically over time the get up and go had got up and left, and they found themselves lying on the track of life for 16 years, going nowhere, doing nothing, and that was them. And so onto the scene bursts God's communicator, onto the scene bursts the guy who God had destined and designed to come and bring his voice to the people. His name is Haggai. And on the 28th of August, 520 BC, here he comes, starts and brings this first of four messages over these 3 months to the people to, as it were, give them the moment and the opportunity to get up again and go again, to get them off the track again and get them going, to put into them what does it take for you to get up again and be transformed. And that's what we want to look at this morning. It's that whole business that it's our considerations that will provoke our transformation. It's when we take time to consider what's going on in our lives that will provoke the transformation in our life. So if you've got a Bible, we're going to read Haggai chapter 1 together. If you don't, it'll be on the screen behind, and let's read it together. It says, in the second year of King Darius, on the first day of the sixth month, the word of the Lord came through the prophet Haggai to Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, the governor of Judah, and to Joshua, the son of Jozadak, the high priest. This is what the Lord Almighty says. These people say the time has not yet come to rebuild the Lord's house. Then the word of the Lord came through the prophet Haggai. Is it time for you yourselves to be living in your paneled houses while my house and this house remains a ruin? Now this is what the Lord Almighty says. Give careful thought to your ways. Consider your ways. You've planted much, but you've harvested little. You eat, but you never have enough. You drink, but you never have your fill. You put on clothes, but you're not warm. You earn wages only to put them in a purse with holes in it. This is what the Lord Almighty says. Give careful thought. Consider your ways. Get up and go up to the mountain and bring down timber and build my house so that I may take pleasure in it and be honored, says the Lord. You expected much, but see, it's turned out to be little. What you brought home, I blew away. Why, declares the Lord Almighty, because of my house, which remains a ruin, while each of you is busy with your own house. Therefore, because of you, the heavens have withheld their dew and the earth its crops. I called for a drought in the fields and the mountains, on the grain and the new wine, the olive oil and everything else the ground produces, on people and livestock and all the labor of your hands. And then Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, and Joshua, the son of Jozadak, the high priest, and the whole remnant of the people obeyed the voice of the Lord their God, and the message of the prophet Haggai, because the Lord their God had sent him. And the people feared the Lord. Then Haggai, the Lord's messenger, gave this message of the Lord to the people. I am with you, declares the Lord. And so the Lord stirred up the spirit of Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, the governor of Judah, stirred up the spirit of Joshua, son of Jozadak, the high priest, and the spirit of the whole remnant of the people. They came and began to work on the house of the Lord Almighty their God on the 24th day of the sixth month. We want to see what happens when we allow our consideration to provoke our transformation. Haggai is actually saying to the people, I want you to pitch up and park yourselves for a season at the place called consideration. I want you to take a stop, and I want you to just take some time and to think and to give some thought and to give careful thought to this thing called consideration. To consider and think about, where are you in your life? What is going on in your life? Where has your life come from, and where is your life going? What is going on in your life at the moment? What is it that will take you to time to pass? The word that is used there is a word that means to put in place, to determine, to give careful thought to appoint or to transform into, to bring to pass. I guess it carries the conception of the concept of the idea that by thinking and considering where you're at, you will come out with a different outcome. You'll come out with a different future. That where you're at the moment will not be where you're going. Where you've been will not be what your future is. It's that element that says, take some time just to think and consider where you are today. When you're on the track and you've fallen down, when you're in the place where you're at today, whether things are going great, where things are going difficult, where you've got the storms of life around you, whatever you're facing, take some time. Park up at that place called consideration and stop and think, well, where is my life going and what am I doing? For them, it was very difficult, and it's very difficult for us sometimes because we live in times of uncertainty as they did. They lived uncertain. They weren't sure. They thought they'd heard God to say, get up and go. And how did life end up like this? God, this was your plan to take me to do this. This was your idea to send us to go and build your house. And why did it end up like this? And so you get to that place of uncertainty. If you don't deal with the uncertainties of your life, you move slowly and very subtly to a place of complacency where you just let things happen to you. And you just carry on doing as you're doing. And that's what they had got to. It was difficult for them to take some time to consider. They'd spent 16 years in the place of complacency. Nothing had happened. They just had carried on doing their life, carry on doing what they were always doing, carry on doing what they thought was the thing they should be doing. They just, every day was the same. They didn't have a bad heart, but just stuff gets into our lives. None of them had a bad intent to disobey God. It just is complacency. If we don't deal with the uncertainties of our life, then it quickly slips into complacency, and we can spend a long time, and we just haven't given much thought as to how we managed to get ourselves into this place. And maybe we're sitting in here this morning, and we know where we're at, but we're like, how did I actually get here? How has my life become like this? And it's the moment where God's saying, this morning, if you're lying on the track of life, if you're not getting up and going, if the get up and go that you once had is now got up and gone, and you're on the track of life, it's time to take some time and park up and consider. Take some time and just think. You see, because if you don't, if you don't deal with complacency, You get to the place of divergency. And divergency is where you compartmentalize your life. That you separate your life and you've got a God bit and you've got a me bit and you've got a rest bit. And you separate your life into different compartments. And that's what they had done. They'd separated their life into this thing they did called worship, but all of their time was spent doing what they were doing, building their own homes, building a life, building a family, building everything. And they had sections for life. I grew up, and that was the world I grew up in. When I was a little boy, I grew up in a world where the expression of our Christianity was a compartmentalized, separate thing. It was a thing we did on a Sunday. I got dressed up on a Sunday because that's what you did. I went and behaved in a particular way on a Sunday because that's what you did. And we went to church every single Sunday. My mom and dad had a fantastic and a lovely heart. They did. They were great people. And I look back with great gratitude for the upbringing I had. But I remember that our Christian outworking was one of compartmentalization. That we did this thing called church. We did this thing called God. It was an activity that we were involved in. It was a pattern of life that we got ourselves engaged in. But it was not all of life. It wasn't a 24/7, 365, all-consuming, that every thought that I had was taken captive because I believed in Jesus and he was a friend of mine. It wasn't that every choice I made and every priority I set was because that God was central to our lives. It wasn't like that. We did this thing. And you see, if we don't deal with some of the journey that they were on, from uncertainty through to complacency and then on to divergency, then life just passes us by. For them, they lay in the track 16 years. They were all in at the beginning. They made their whole lives available for God. They said, yes, we're going to do everything it takes. But slowly, separation happens. And slowly, they put themselves in compartments. And God speaks to Haggai, and in these early verses, four times it says, thus says God. This is what God says. These are the words of God Almighty. And he's actually saying to Haggai, Haggai, I want you to say to the people, yes, they need to park up in that place called consider. But actually, there's more detail to it than that. It's not just generally consider. I'm going to give you some framework for them that will help them to make the considerations they need to do. And it's going to be helpful for us, I hope, this morning as we look at that today. You see, every get up and go should be preceded by a give time to consider. For whatever God has got planned for you to do, wherever he's got planned for you to go, that wherever the next step of your life, it should always be preceded by, I need to take time just to consider, what are you saying, God? Where am I? Where have I been? Where am I going? What's happening in my life now? And there's three simple observations from this chapter that I think Haggai wanted to say to the people there. Stop. Give some time. Consider your ways. But they're framed up in simple things that you and I can see. They're framed up, number one, in reflecting on our yesterdays. Reflecting on our yesterdays. And for all of us in the room, we need to take time to consider and give thought to what happened in my life yesterday. Verses 2 to 4 invites them to look back over the last 16 years. Haggai describes what they have said, and he describes what he has seen. You see, what he's seen is passivity sitting. What he saw was they're just sitting, doing nothing with the building of God's house. They were doing nothing with what was going on. They let other things kind of overtake them. They'd come to that place of, well, maybe someday, but not today. And maybe for we're sitting in here today, and we're here in church, but in terms of giving our whole selves to God, giving everything to get up and go for him, being all in, as it were, maybe someday, but not today, because we're in that place of passivity sitting. I remember when my boy was a little boy, we used to take corks, you know, that you get out of bottles, and we'd put them in the stream that was up just from our home. Loved that, watching the corks race down the stream. Am I alone with that? Anybody else? No. You'd put a little flag in them, and I would race with him. I was always disappointed when he beat me, but I mean, it's such a random thing to do. But you put the cork in the water. They've covered over the stream. It's all this, memories are gone. But anyway, put the thing in the stream, and you'd watch, and you'd cheer on your cork as it bobbed along just by the will of the water. But of course, what happens sometimes is little currents would take it off to the side. You get irritated because your cork was in the side. Sometimes there would be twigs and little things that would be in the way, and the cork would get stopped, and his cork would fly past mine. I'd try and chuck in a stone just to stop him, you know, as a dad would do. But life is like that. When you just wait and see where the flow takes you, then there'll always be currents that will take you off to the side. There'll always be things that come up in front of you and block your way. That's what passivity sitting is like. And for them, there was all this challenge of discouragement that had come into their world. They'd lost momentum because division and separation. Counselors had come, as you remember last week, to take them in different directions. And now they arrived at a place where they were just sitting passively and letting life come at them. It was not only about sitting passively, it's about priority setting too. The building of the house of God was no longer a priority for them. It was no longer first place in their life. And God spoke a second time and said and reflected on where their yesterdays have got to. And he said, you know what? Now it's your personal priority that's got ahead of God's purpose. That which you want to do has now taken precedence over what God wanted you to do. And the challenge is we look back and consider where have we come from and what's going on as we reflect on our yesterdays. And maybe for some in the room today, we can say, you know what, I've just been passively letting life take me where it's taken me. I've been passively letting things happen in my life. Maybe for some it's a recognition that, you know what, I know as I look back that I haven't put God first. I love him dearly. I love him in my life. He's done so much for me, but I acknowledge it day by day. My priorities are my priorities. What I want to do, where I want to go, how I want to put my money, what I want to do with my time, what I want to do with my energy, that's what I'm going to do. And building the house of God is no longer a priority. In verse 9, he said, my house remains a ruin while each of you is busy with your own house. It's an opportunity for us. And Haggai comes to you and I today and he says, consider your ways, give careful thought and reflect on your yesterdays. Where have you arrived at? Who have you become? Who are you today? What are your priorities? Consider, give careful thought. You see, it's the addition of our yesterdays that actually shape the equation of our todays. It's when you add up all your yesterdays that actually makes the equation of where you are today. And if there was a second thing that he wants to say to the people here, it's about reframing our todays. As he said to them in verses 5 right through to 11, he said to them, you know what, you've planted a whole bunch of stuff, but nothing's happened to it. You've got food and water, but you're always thirsty. You've got clothes on, but they never seem to keep you warm when the storms come. You're investing in putting your money, your wages into your pockets, but your pockets have got holes. You know, nothing seems to be working for you. Nothing seems to be going in your lives. And for them, as they began to consider their ways and began, he was saying, I need you to reframe what you see as your days, as your todays. When you look at where you're at today, how do you see that? What is the perspective that you see how your life is going today, right this day? What do you see is going on in your life and in your choices and your priorities and where you're at today? The opposition, you see, was not what they expected. They expected when God said, I want you to go and build a house, that's what we're going to do and it's going to be amazing and everything's going to be fantastic. They didn't anticipate there was going to be opposition. They didn't think that was going to be their expectation. They didn't think that their daily condition was as it was. When you become a Christian, you give your life to Jesus, surely that's going to be better than it was before. And of course it is. Your sins are forgiven. But sometimes it doesn't feel that way, huh? When all the storms and the difficulties come our way, when tragedy comes here and opposition comes there and disappointments come and we find ourselves we're not who we think we are and we're not becoming who we thought we were going to be and the promises and the dreams that we have don't become the reality and we arrive at today thinking, I didn't think there was going to be this opposition. I didn't think this was my condition. And for them, they didn't even think this was going to be the connection they had with God. For all of a sudden, they realize actually the intense relationship that we thought we were going to have as we worshiped him and we all praised him, we're not there anymore. It's not happening anymore. It seems as though we've turned down the gas and we've put God on the side. He's almost the shepherd on the shelf. That we'll bring the shepherd out when we need a bit of guidance. We'll take him down off the shelf, but most of the time we've compartmentalized and put him up there. You see, what had happened when they were reframing their days, Haggai was trying to say to them, but you've got misplaced alignment. You're not aligned with what God sees. How God sees your life is not how you see your life. How God sees your condition is not how you see it. And they were describing here, they've got all the process, but no the results. They seemed to be doing the right thing, but nothing was happening. They were sowing seeds, but there was no result. He says, you've got provision, but not what required. You eat and you drink, but there's never enough. You've always in that place of lack. There always seems to be poverty in your life. And not, I'm not just talking financial, but what other kind of poverty can you get? Relational poverty, emotional poverty. There always seems to be something you're lacking. You have all the provision, but it's never enough to keep you going in the life that you're living. There's protection, but it's not robust enough. When you've got your clothes that you're wearing, but it doesn't keep you warm. Why? Because this, when the storm comes, it's never enough to keep you warm. You've got some level of protection, but when the storm comes in your life, it flows you all over the place and you don't manage the storms when the storms of life come. You've got the protection, you've got Jesus, but how come he doesn't seem to be enough? How come he doesn't seem to be making the difference in the difficult storms of your life? And then, of course, you've got prospect, but no return. You invest in stuff and it just seems to disappear. Where you put your energies never seem to come and bring anything out of them. It just evaporates. And Haggai is saying, it's because of your misplaced alignment. You've not aligned your life with how God sees your life. The people give no explanation for their situation, but God reveals an amazing and very surprising truth. In verses 9 to 11, he says, I blew away what you thought you could keep. I withheld from you what you relied upon. It was because of you and your priority setting and your passivity sitting and the house of God is in ruin. I have allowed these things to take place in your life. Oy. I'm not saying that God brings bad things into your lives, but things that are bad happen in our lives. And we need to sometimes take stock and consider and think, why is this happening, God? And I'm not saying every occasion is because God is trying, as he was here, to get us to stop and consider. But maybe this whole journey of being a Christian is a dead simple thing. It maybe is just about obeying him. It maybe is just about putting him first. It maybe is just about building his house in your heart and building his house together. Maybe it is as simple as that. Because for these people, they end up on the ground with a torn hamstring, and they're lying there for 16 years in that place of passivity sitting, in that place of different priority setting, and they can't understand why the life that they're living is not amounting to much. And God comes and says, it's because you're not putting me first. It's because you're not building my house. It's because you're not getting your priorities right. Often we just think that's just the way it is. But God is reminding the people to consider their ways and give thought to their circumstances. Perhaps it's time today for us to reframe our todays into how God sees them. And maybe we do underestimate just the simplicity. But I actually love how God, with God, failure is never final. Isn't that amazing? That our failures as we sit in here today, and my failure to put him first in all things, to engage him in everything, my failure of sometimes compartmentalizing my expression of what it means to follow Jesus, my failure of sometimes putting my priorities wrong, I love it how God doesn't make failure final for us. Because in verse 1 it says, we skip over it because it's the introduction, but it's so powerful because it says, in this second year, in the first day of the sixth month, the word of the Lord came from Haggai to who? To Zerubbabel and to Joshua. I love that. It's them that have led the 16 years of failure. It is them that have overseen this disastrous last 16 years. It is them who never did anything about the passivity, who never did anything about the priority. It's them still that God comes with grace and says, I want to speak to you again. I want to give you the second chance. I want to give you the fifth chance. I want to give you the tenth chance. I love that about our God. I love when we met up, he's able to clean up. I love when we go astray, he's able to show there is a way. When we go wrong, he's there to make it right. Isn't that our God? Hallelujah. He's amazing for you and for me. And we overlook that. But yet here he comes with a new assignment. Here he comes and says, give careful thought, not only to reflect back on your yesterdays, not only to reframe your days, but actually to refresh your tomorrows. Refresh your tomorrows. Aren't you glad that the Bible is full of thens? T-H-E-N, then moments. Because there it says in verse, where is it? In verse 12. It says once they've gone, considered all the past, and God has spoken to them about what is going on, and God has told them this is the reason why you're in the situation you're in today, as you look back in your past and you bring it to today, and in verse 12 begins, then Zerubbabel, then Joshua, then the high priest, and then the people obeyed the word of the God. I love it. Because of what they heard, because of what they understood, because of what they considered, because of what they took time, a change took place, transformation happened, their future was forever changed. You know that this is the only place in the Old Testament when a prophet comes and says, consider your ways, give thought to where you're at. You need to change your ways. This is the only place where actually it says the people obeyed. Come on. The people obeyed. They turned everything around. They got up and they began to build again. Why did they do that? Three simple things as we finish this morning. Number one is they recognized whose voice. Recognized whose voice they were listening to. They were understanding that the voice that Haggai was speaking was actually the voice of the living God. They realized that that was his voice. So easy for familiarity to become our reality. We come here Sunday by Sunday, we sing, we pray, we praise God, that we would once again recognize it's God who's speaking to you and me. It's God who wants to come and communicate with us. It's more than singing songs, it's more than praying prayers, it's more than listening to sermons. It's the creator of the universe who wants to endeavor to communicate his spirit through his voice to you and me, saying get up and go, saying build my house, saying get up and build the house of God in your heart, which is us living stones. And we need to recognize again it's his voice that's talking to us when we gather together. Let's not be familiar again, but the voices we sing and declare, they're God's voice to you and me. The prayers that are prayed, that's God's voice to you and me. When we are hearing people are trying to communicate, it's endeavoring to communicate God's voice to us. It's the realization, it's the recognition of whose voice is speaking to you this morning. It's not mine. It's what God wants to say to you and me through his word. It's the restoration of willing sacrifice. It says, he stirred up Zerubbabel, stirred up Joshua, stirred up the people. I love that. The word that is used there is almost to rouse, to get excited, to be triumphant. How did he do that? He said, well, I'll tell you how I did that. I come and I said, I am with you. The circumstances hadn't changed. They were still in a place of poverty. They were still in a place of lack. There were still storms and oppositions. Nothing around them had changed. But what had changed was the revelation of who was with them. It's the revelation that God was with them. And that stirred them up inside. If we could get a revelation of that today, that God is with you in every aspect and every area of our life. When the storm comes, God is with us. Hallelujah. He will never leave us or forsake us. He is there inspiring and putting into you and me that reality. Come on, you can get up again. Come on, you don't need to be lying again. Come on, it's no place to be lying in this generation. It's time to get up and go because I am with you in every aspect of your life. And of course, it meant for them that recalibration of their choices. Because it's consideration and taking time to consider that provokes our transformation. He said, get up and go up the mountain, get the timber, come back and build the house. Go where you need to go, get what you need to get, and come back and do what you need to do. Go where you need to go, get what you need to get, and come back and do what you need to do. And for us, as King's Community Church, he's saying to all of us, come on, I need you to go up the mountain. I need you to get the timber, and I need you to get on and build. There's so many aspects to that, and we're not going to talk about them today, but for some in here, it's what do you need to get to build God's house? What's your timber? What has he asked you to provide that you're not making available? What is the timber that you're carrying in your hand that he's saying, it's time to make that available for building my house in this city? I don't know what it is. You know. Whether it's your wisdom, whether it's your gift, whether it's your experience, whether it's your prayers, whether it's your skill, whether it's your talent, whether it's your time. Hey, we're all at different stages of life and we're sometimes not able to offer everything. What we could do as a young person, we offer our time and our energy. Maybe we're not able to do that anymore as an older person, but as an older person, perhaps we're able to offer our prayers. Maybe we're able to offer our wisdom and experience. Whereas when you're a young person, it's time and energy and zeal and zip. But God knows what is the timber in your hand that you're able to make available, whether it's your finance, whether it's the good things that God has placed within you, your availability, your willingness. Everyone in this room has got timber in their hand to build the house of God. But maybe for others today, it's what mountain do you need to climb to go and get what you need to do to build God's house in your heart. Maybe it's the mountain of fear that you need to climb. The fear of what people will think, the fear of a different future, the fear of not being in control, the fear of not making the primary choices, the fear that God will somehow do something crazy with your life, the fear that you're going to have to go far away and do something. No. Well, maybe your mountain is fear. Maybe your mountain is pride and self-reliance. I can make it on my own. Thank you so much. Maybe your mountain is the mountain of secrecy, having to come clean with who you really are before God. Maybe it's the mountain of forgiveness. I think it would be great for us to take a moment to respond this morning. And just, it's not going to be a big deal. It may not be that you need somebody to pray with you. But if you want that, somebody would happily do that. But come on, we'll stand. I'll pray and then I'll just give me an invitation. If you need to come and respond to God today, if you want to take a moment in your calendar, in your diary, to say, this is the day that I made my consideration. This is the day that I stepped forward from where my past was taking me and where my past has taken me to. This was the day that my future shifted. And this was the day with the beginning of transformation. If that's you today and you want to mark that either on the fly leaf of your memory or on the fly leaf of your Bible and you put against Haggai this date, then mark it. Come down. And somebody would love to pray with you if you want that. But maybe it's just a case of coming down. The band are probably going to play and they're going to pray reasonably quietly. And you can come and just do that. Father, we pray for everyone in the room this morning, God. We thank you, Lord, that we don't end up in the track for good, Lord. We thank you, Father, that you are our Father who comes alongside us and puts your arm around us and lifts us up out of the track of life, Lord, that we've fallen on, and invites us again, puts your arm around us and runs with us, God, into the future that is ours. And so, Father, pray for everyone in this room today, God. Oh, Lord, that all of us would take time to stay at that place called consideration. And, Lord, we'd lift again and go again and get up again and live for you again and build your house again and build your house in our home again and put you first again. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Amen.